How are you, man?
Good. Glad to be doing this.
Me too. It's a fucking thirsty Thursday. How are you?
Good. Glad to be on a half day at work. Had some Taco Bell before this, so
Shit. What'd you get from Taco Bell?
What didn't I get?
That's the better question there. I like it.
And it's like $15. Like you order, you black out when you order, and then all of a sudden you're like, where did I get all this stuff?
I usually black out before I order Taco Bell. But that's neither here nor there. Where you at in the world, man?
Jersey.
A Jersey guy. Yep. All right, cool. One of my very good friends moved out here from Jersey, was a neighbor for a long time. He just moved away, not very far. He moved to the beach. But yeah, I'm familiar with some Jersey humor, so maybe this will come out in this episode.
Yeah, definitely.
Well, man, let's get into it a little bit. Are you a drinker of some kind?
Every once in a while, more like hard liquor, you know, like Jack Daniels or Jaeger, I prefer. Still can't stand wine. It's like I'm a 5-year-old, like trying to drink it. I make a face. It's not good.
That's all good, man. Do you drink beer?
Yeah, every once in a while, like yeah. Sam Adams or kind of a little bit of anything.
Sam Adams, but you're in Jersey, man. You can't drink a Boston Lager.
I don't know. I'm not an IPA guy either, and they're all over here. It's all just.
Well, you got the East Coast IPAs. You need to come. You got to come check out the West Coast IPAs.
You're right. I gotta give it a try.
Yeah, like this one. Yeah, like, I don't know if you heard about this one. The Drinks with Johnny Filthy IPA. You might want to try that one out sometime.
Yeah, definitely.
So I see you got a bit of a basketball hat on there. Is that what? That's a play on basketball.
You ever see Tom Segura and Bert Kreischer's podcast, Two Bears, One Cave?
Yeah. Oh, that's what it is. Okay.
Yeah.
Right on. No, I have seen and I have heard. I'm a fan of both those guys as comedians and podcasters. I got to be honest. It's not like I listen to their podcast on the regular, but I have seen it a little bit. And I mean, they're fucking awesome.
Yeah, I have a little 2-year-old running around, so I don't really get whenever I get the chance, I put it on. But she repeats everything, so if she's around, I do not put it on. That's all I need.
No, you just got to let them repeat that shit. So you got a 2-year-old. Do you have any other kids?
Nah, just a 2-year-old. Born the day the world shut down.
Oh, really? So was
March 13th, 2020.
Wow. That's a crazy life she just got into right away, huh? Well, at least she won't really remember it. So that's also
no. Fun. I mean, even at this point, it's a big difference. But she was used to seeing people with masks on and everything, so it's crazy. Yeah. I can't believe, you know, we had a kid and then everything shut down.
Right on. I mean, you got. In some respect, you got to spend a lot of time with your kid, though, at a very young age, you know, not going into work, I imagine. Or what do you do for a living?
Yeah, I work for an insurance company. I'm an estimator for them.
Okay.
So I've had my paternity leave, and then we were from home, too, for a couple months. So I pretty much, the whole time my wife was home, I was home. So it worked out great, some extra time.
Yeah. That's always a good thing, get to see the kids raise up like that. Are you guys one and doneers, you think? Are you going to have another kid?
Probably another one soon, because we don't want to have too crazy of an age gap. She wants 3, I want 2, so I'm sure we're going to compromise and have 3.
Yeah, that's a nice compromise. That's a smart husband compromise right there. But I mean, at least you get the fun of making it, right? You know, like that's always,
exactly.
That's always the good part, you know. Like, not enough gets talked about the feeling of making the child. I think, like, that's, you know, everyone's like, oh, it's so awesome to have a kid, and it is. But you know, making it's pretty fun too, guys.
Yeah, exactly. Everyone leaves that part out.
So, you said you listened to that podcast, Two Bears, One Cave. Are there any other podcasts you're listening to?
Yeah, listen to your podcast all the time. Listen to Rob Flynn's podcast.
Okay.
Doc Coyle's podcast.
Mm.
So just pretty much anything that's behind the scenes, whether it's because Two Bears, One Cave is kind of behind the scenes comedy wise, which I think is really cool. And then, you know, anywhere that where I can hear more about musicians, the way the process works, the way everything goes is always really cool. I like keeping up on as much as I can with what's going on in music now.
Oh, right on. You are you a musician as well? Do you play? Oh, that's right. You're a, bass player. Yeah, yep. Sam, our producer, said that you're a bass player. How long have you been playing, man?
Since 2007, 2008.
Right on, right on. What kind of bass you got?
I've got a Stingray 5, and I've got a Jazz 5 Ultra, one of the newer Fenders they came out with. Updated, like, the profile and everything.
Right on.
It's really cool.
You're a 5-stringer, then.
Yeah, my first band was in like 07, 08. Huge Korn fans, so we were right into 7-strings, so I had to have a 5 to match it.
Yeah, you got to have that low B on it, right?
Yeah, exactly. So we did all that and had all that fun. Now I do cover music. And
do you have a cover band that you play? Do you have a cover band you play gigs with and stuff?
Yeah, we've been gigging here and there. With COVID, it's been kind of tough.
Right.
But we've been gigging when we can, you know. I realized you actually make money playing cover music versus playing death metal. Who would have thought?
I mean, I think there's money in both, but depends on your crowd and what you're going. I mean, I've heard of some weddings having some death metal bands play. So, you know, I'm sure you get paid doing that.
Really?
I've heard of it. My wife wouldn't go for it, but you know.
No, neither would mine. My wife just can't stand it. She's all about country.
She's all about country. Okay. And you're more of a hard rock and metal guy?
Yeah, more rock and metal. And I've definitely learned to appreciate country through doing the cover stuff. I never realized how much country uses low B. Like, there's so many 5-string players in country music.
Oh, yeah. In country music in general, they're just great players, right? I mean, a lot of, yeah. Especially these days.
Stuff in those songs.
Oh, hell yeah. I mean, yeah, if you get a chance, just go out to Nashville. Walk Broadway Street and hop into any bar, just any bar on Broadway Street, and you're going to see some great musicians playing some great country music. At least that's been my experience. Like, they have some awesome players, like, to your point. I mean, a lot of these guys are studio cats that will go out and play on Broadway just for fun, you know? And, like, you know how it is. If you're a studio cat, you know how to play pretty fucking well, so.
Yeah, exactly.
And so you said you were earlier on, you were doing like some Korn stuff, some Korn covers. So you're a bit of a slapper then, yeah?
As much as you would need to play Korn. I'm serviceable. I'm a finger style guy, but okay. I'm not Flea. I'm not Les Claypool.
Right.
I'm all finger style though.
Yeah. Well, not many are. You know, you put a pretty big number on those two you just named right there with Flea and Claypool. Two of my personal favorites as well, man. So you also said you listen to podcasts. You listen to this show. Excuse me. Hairball. Cut that out later. Probably not.
Yeah. Whatever.
Yeah.
There's like a pound of pollen every day I wake up anyway.
What's that?
There's like a pound of pollen here whenever I walk out the door. Everyone's just sick and sniffling and coughing and sneezing. It's awful.
Yeah. Well, that's going to happen after, you know, everyone's been isolating for 2 years. You know, it's like, shit.
Exactly.
Germs again, huh? Right on. Let's go.
yeah. And having a nice 2-year-old to bring it home from daycare is awesome too.
And that's new to you now. So, like, we got, like, us, I have a 5-year-old. So, I already had him bringing home the colds, everything like that. He was in preschool. We were like, you know, you're just constantly sick when your kids are young. Like, it's not the worst sicknesses or anything like that, but you always have, like, a cough or a runny nose in the house. Someone's got it, you know, whatever. You learn to live with it for the first few years. And then there was,
did he,
like,
grow out of it at this point, or?
What's that?
Did he grow out of it at this point, or is he still coming?
Well,
home
no, because there that was yeah, no, because there was that time when he wasn't in school and wasn't around other kids, so that kind of, I feel like, delayed a lot of that natural immune building to the more common things, you know. So now he's getting them again back in school. You know, he's been back in school for a while now, but yeah, it's starting to happen again, and you know, it's just, you roll with the punches. You know how it is. You're a parent.
Yep.
And there's nothing. There's nothing you do to, like, prepare. You're not a superhero. You're not nothing. This is the shit you're given, and you fucking do with it what you can, each and every day.
You know, it's funny. I was talking to my band guys about doing this, and I was like, you know what's funny is I've been a fan of you guys since City of Evil came out, probably a little after. The first album I really like went through the tour cycle of was the self-titled. Mm-hmm. But I'm like, 15-year-old me would have never thought I'd be talking to you about kids.
Me neither, man.
And I'm like, times change, and you know, you think you'd be talking about partying and you know all that stuff, and now you're talking about your kids.
Yeah, that's basically how this podcast goes. Is you know, listening to it and stuff. Sometimes you know, it depends on who we have on the show. We just let it go, and you know, you find a common ground, something to speak on. And the fact that you have a 2-year-old, you got a 5-year-old, it's easy to talk on, right? And yeah, yep. Just having those fucking little kids, man, changes everything.
Yeah, it really does. You don't know you can love something that much, right? You know?
Yeah, that's absolutely true, man. How long you been with your wife?
We've been together 10 years. Been married for coming up on 4.
Wow, congratulations.
Thank you.
That's rad, that's rad. I want to get back to the podcast, though, real quick. You said you predominantly listen to podcasts. Does that include this one, or you watch it on YouTube?
I listen to you on Spotify when I'm doing chores.
Beautiful. I love that.
Throw it on headphones and then, you know, go and do laundry, clean the bathrooms, do all that type of fun stuff.
You know, I love that you say that because that's predominantly when I listen to podcasts too. Throw on the headphones, either I'm out on a walk, working out, whatever it may be, doing some chores around the house. That's a time when I'm listening to a lot of podcasts. I'm listening to some wrestling podcasts though. I'm a big professional wrestling fan, as I'm sure you know from listening to this podcast. Yep.
I never got into it, huh?
Did you ever give it a try, or did you just like, yeah?
I guess it just kind of passed me by. I don't know. I was just always super into music, and I guess that's what I always focused on.
Yeah, I get that. Yeah, I mean, that was the time for me growing up, being a wrestling fan, and then there was a time when I didn't watch it as much, and that was when I was really focused on music, and then you find a way to balance both of them. It's not too late for you, Robert, is what I'm saying. It's never too late to become a wrestling fan, especially if you're going to have young kids. I just took my son to his first live event of AEW wrestling. Man, just watching him light up made it all fucking worth it, and to know what was going on and teach him how to cheer along and be the best, you know, you gotta play the heel sometimes with your kids so that they feel like they got one over on you when they're cheering for the good guys. You know, it's just
too much. Did he hold up throughout the whole thing, or did he get kind of antsy after a while?
No, he was riveted the whole time. That's awesome. The part that I was just like, holy shit, this is awesome. So I didn't know how it was gonna be, and he's just like standing up on the chair, cheering along the whole time. Any big move would happen, he'd look over at me and be like, oh, did you see that? And I'm like, fuck yeah, I saw that. That was rad.
That's awesome.
Even though I wasn't probably watching, I said I saw it when I was really watching him, you know?
Yeah.
It was so much fun. So just fun things like that, having kids and doing that. And obviously for me, I just love wrestling, and I always have, and they're doing good stuff now. Are you into any other sports? What else tickles your fancy, as they say?
I'm a Steelers fan.
Okay.
And a big hockey fan. I'm a Devils fan, so I mean, playoffs never matter. Haven't mattered to me for a long time. But actually, kind of excited for the Rangers. I think it's kind of sacrilegious to say, but just to have someone that's, you know, in the tri-state area getting that high up is pretty damn cool.
Yeah, I mean, I understand that. You know, there's been some down years for my football team here. So, you know, as a Raiders fan, but they're on the up and up now, I think. So we're going to be okay. And I've always loved the Steelers, by the way. I've never been an anti-Steelers. My father's team is the Pittsburgh Steelers. My best friend, Sinister Gates, big Steelers fan. Got a lot of Steelers fans. Yeah. So, I mean, I don't hate on them. If they're playing the Raiders, obviously I'm rooting for the Raiders.
Yeah, you have to.
Other than that, I'm okay with the Steelers going on and doing some good shit. They had a great run with Big Ben. It's going to be interesting to see what Tomlin can do with the team moving forward, you know, kind of having to rebuild it.
Yeah, he never had a losing record, so we'll see if that changes this year. He'll find a way.
I think he'll find a way to not have a losing record. He's already proven that. What was it, the third string quarterback he did a couple years ago, or third or fourth?
Yeah, like 2 or 3 years ago, and they still I think they ended up breaking even or close to it.
Yeah, they broke even. Yeah, they broke even. It was before the extended season of last year, so they went 8-8. And it was in the division with the Ravens, you know, not a slouch team. Of course, then, and I think the Browns were coming up a little bit, and Cincinnati sucked at that time. But now, I mean, it's just crazy. You see Cincinnati come back, and they're in the Super Bowl. Beat my Raiders by one touchdown, by the way, and then the refs, of course, got fired for the rest of the playoffs. I don't know how that happens, but it seems to only happen to my Raiders, but whatever. You know, so you got a tough division. What are you thinking for your chances coming up this season?
I'm not expecting much, and I feel like that always ends up being better.
low expectations.
If I go in with low expectations, anything that's slightly better is nice. So I'll take it.
Absolutely. So, and you also said you're a hockey fan. I'm more of a, you know, kind of fair weather. I don't truly start watching hockey until the Stanley Cup playoffs really start. And before that, I'll catch a few games here and there. I'm a Kings fan. So they actually made it this year with a younger team, a couple of veterans. And they held their own kind of okay against Edmonton Oilers, who ended up showing that they were one of the better teams until very recently, and it left. So
yeah.
Who do you got winning it all this year?
It's tough. I really think the Avalanche might do it. Mm-hmm. I'd love to see the Rangers do it, but Tampa Bay just has a history, too, of, you know, they're very experienced at being in this situation, so.
Yeah, I mean, you got a good point.
It's really tough to say. I mean, that's the kind of the cool thing lately is everything's just been so up in the air with everything that you kind of can't even tell. You think it's going one way, then all of a sudden you're in game seven.
Well, that's the beauty of sports, man. That's why we watch, you know. That's what it's all about. So I'm excited for that. You watching any of the NBA finals?
I can't get into basketball.
Can't get into ever or yeah.
No, I've been there in person. It just does nothing for me.
All right then, we'll move on.
Yeah, I love hockey, but I can't get into NBA at all.
That's fair, man. I mean, everyone's got their own opinion, what they get into and stuff, and that's great, man. I'm a big Lakers fan, being in LA, so I've always grown up watching the games. Maybe you could turn me on to some shows or movies, though. Like, your kid's still young enough that she probably goes to bed at a reasonable hour, and you get some time to you know, watch some movies or TV shows with your wife, get caught up after. You know, kid probably goes to bed, what, like 6-7 o'clock at night?
She's been going to bed closer to 9 lately. I don't know what's going on.
Oh, well, now you're fucked.
Yeah, exactly. Like 7 was cool. 7:30 was cool. Then it started going to 8. Now it's like almost 9 o'clock, and she makes every excuse not to go to bed.
It's the twos. Yeah, the terrible twos, as they say. I found the threes to be a little bit worse, and... with boys.
That's what I've heard. I've heard 3 is worse than 2, which, oh boy.
Well, you got a daughter too. And from my understanding, they're a little bit easier as toddlers. And then when they get to be teenagers, can be worse. And it's vice versa for the boys.
Yeah, I'm enjoying her. I'm enjoying her being a daddy's girl right now. Mm. But I know at some point that switch is going to flip and she'll hate me for a little bit. So, you know.
I don't know if they ever hate you. You don't need to throw that word out.
All right, I embarrass. I embarrass her. How about that?
Well, that's every dad's duty is to embarrass their
children.
Yeah,
it's my job.
Yeah. Like, I can't wait to do that. Like, oh, that's going to be so good. That's going to be so good. But back to, like, letting them curse and curse around. That's something I did with my son. I don't know if you want to take this advice or say, it doesn't work for me, Johnny. You fucking suck. Letting him curse around you and stuff. My son now flips me off and tells me I look like shit. And sings "It's Your Fucking Nightmare" and all the songs with all the bad words in it.
Is he into Avenged at all, or
He's into that song because
kind of get it yet.
No, I mean he likes it when he hears it. He's you tell him, you know, it's daddy and your uncles, you know, blah blah blah, and he's like, oh, that's cool. And then he wants to hear one of his songs. He wants to hear something else. So, you know, I don't know yet. And but even from a very young age, like you're saying, as early as Frankie was able to speak, I had him listening to Nightmare and singing along to the lyrics. So,
that's awesome.
Yeah, and then you just tell him.
Like Slipknot, I haven't figured it out why, that's but awesome. It would calm her down randomly. I'm like, okay, I'll take it.
That's beautiful. That's a beautiful thing right there. You got a rocker right there. That's awesome.
Yeah, I try to play as much. She'll go like this. Just bob her head. I'm like, yeah, that's what you do. That's perfect.
Yeah.
I had her with my bass one time. I'm glad it was a bass. She grabbed the string and pulled it, and I was like, oh God.
Yeah.
Those like maybe we're not ready for that yet.
Yeah, those things are usually pretty indestructible. So you lifted them up. Yeah, yeah. Are you That brings me back to some bass questions for you. Are you did you take lessons, self-taught? What was your journey through learning the bass?
I took some lessons, and then from there, I just kind of became self-taught. I never learned to read sheet music, which I kind of wish I would have, but it's pretty much all by ear and then just kind of working it out till it's right.
Right on, man. And are you doing any original music, or are you sticking to the covers these days?
I am. So my band that I play with as a cover band is actually I need your opinion on this. I don't like the band name. It's called Sticker the Cooler. I need your completely honest opinion on that as a cover band name.
Sticker the Cooler. Sticker the Cooler. Sticker the Cooler. I have to say it a few times. Sorry. I don't understand it. Let's put it that way.
I don't either.
Not that you necessarily need a name that everyone understands, though. I mean, I've been called many things in the band name that we have, but and many, many times over been asked the question of what it means. Sticker the Cooler.
It's like because we're supposed to be like tailgate music. So okay. Then I guess there's stickers on coolers. I don't know.
Sticker the Cooler. I mean, it's not terrible. What kind of music is the original stuff?
So the original stuff is with that band, but with we have another singer, and they're called Scarlet Carson. We actually worked together with our last single we did was with Josh Wilbur.
Oh,
he actually mixed it.
That's hilarious. Tell Josh I said hello. I haven't seen him in a minute.
Yeah, we released it back in 2020. It's called Further Down Again. It's pretty heavy, you know. It's good. It's not not death metal or anything, but it's some rocking stuff. It's pretty cool. We're hoping to get some more stuff out as the originals. Our singer lives in LA though, so he depends on when he's available to do shows and things like that, especially with the way the pandemic was. But
right,
original stuff is where my heart lies. Cover music's just fun.
Yeah. Like you said, though, it's you know, you got a day job and stuff like that. You get to go out and do some cover band stuff. It's fun to perform a little bit. And then you're also getting a little bit of an outlet and doing the original stuff and trying that out, which is, I mean, yeah, it sounds like you're doing all the right things, man.
Yeah, it's fun. We recently just went into using modelers only for shows, and it's a game changer for covers. Yeah. I run a Helix now. Are you guys still running live rigs? Like, I know you haven't toured since like 18, but were you still running GKs back then, or were you running modelers?
Well, I wasn't doing GKs anymore. The last thing I had was dark glass heads.
Okay, so, I have the B7K and I love it.
Yeah, I actually, I love GK. I've used GK on predominantly on most of the tracks I've recorded since City of Evil. They're amazing, but for the live setting, for whatever reason, we AB'd a dark glass and a GK that I was using, and for whatever reason, through the PAs and stuff and through the sound system with the sound engineer we had, dark glass wanted out, and so I went with them for a while. Gates has had a mixture of his Hellwind heads and a modeler. Used the Fractal before
Those are nuts. There's so much to those.
Yeah. Well, you need a tech. You need a tech for this.
Yeah, my guitarist runs the Axe FX 3 for everything, and I'm like, all right, I'm gonna use the Helix is way more user friendly.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, that's what we use when we're demoing. I mean, we all have demo studios in our houses and stuff like that where we do a lot of writing. And for that, it's super easy. You can switch between so many different sounds and stuff.
It's such on a one game track. Changer.
Yeah, it's and they sound great. I mean, they keep every time they do a new update or something like that. It just seems to be getting better and better. Modelers are a game changer. I've heard from a lot of as to your point, we haven't been out in 4 years. A lot has changed in modelers for that, and I'm sure that's where we're going to end up heading. You know, I know. Our friends at Metallica had switched over to those a while ago. So
I was shocked. I couldn't tell at first. There was a lot of bands you can kind of hear it. But I actually saw it was Volbeat, you guys, and them at MetLife.
Oh, you were at that show? Right on.
Yeah, it was last time I saw you guys. And I saw their rig run down, and it was Axe FX, and I was shocked. You couldn't tell.
Oh, yeah, no. I mean, that's you know, no disrespect on the guys who did it first back in the day, Line 6, but it's come a long way since those Line 6s, you know what I mean? So it's like...
since like the spider amps and the little like red bean thing, it's night and day.
Yeah, but it is awesome to have, though, and I think that's, you know, as you know, when you're on stage and stuff, you're dealing with a live amp and stuff like that, there are some things like... feedback and matters of that a modeler really just kind of cuts out the BS of having to deal with that. If you could get a good enough sound that sounds natural and has those warm tones, which they've pretty much gotten, and they only keep getting better. I don't even know how they keep getting better at these emulations, to the point where now I don't even feel like they're emulations anymore. Those are just the sounds that they're making, which is fucking incredible that technology has come this far. And I think it's a no-brainer. I mean, especially when for you cover bands, what do you got to bring? This little guy right here, this little guy, and my bass. That's
literally
it.
It's like the size of a pedal board, and then my bass, and we have an in-ear rig, which playing without an amp blasting behind you for the first time is weird. But then
you get used to
it. Know, it's pretty cool. It's nice to be able to hear everything.
Right, right.
You know.
Yeah, we haven't had since we had in-ears, we haven't had real speakers on stage in a very, very long time. Like, you know,
were you just running like ISO cabs then for everything?
ISO cabs, we were doing ISO cabs for a long time. Bass was always in an ISO cab, and then we kind of slowly moved away from even the ISO cabs and just running it off the heads. I mean, for a while there, I just have the bass so I could feel the rumble, to your point, on the stage, right. You know. But then, you know, get the subwoofers doing that too for you from the PA system. So again, it's just a lot of getting used to it and stuff like that. But I mean, I'm fucking jealous, to be honest, of these kids who are gonna start their bands and start playing shows and stuff like that, and they get to walk around like you are right now with a little fucking thing. And I had to lug in an 8x10 and a big Ampeg fucking tube head, you know.
I used to lug. I had an SWR. I have an SWR half stack that I, you know, when I need an amp. But lugging that around was enough versus like an 8x10. But have you seen the Dark Glass? They have that new. It's a modeler head, so they put it in a head form. It uses a phone now to go through all the different patches and everything. I think it strictly uses Dark Glass, like what they already have in their library, but they keep expanding it. It's kind of supposed to be their answer to the modelers. Oh. And you can run that as a head. You can run it as a modeler itself. And it's pretty cool.
I'm sure I'm going to be getting into all these things hopefully sooner than later, because I do need a refresher course after this many years of what's out there and what I can use. But I'm glad you just brought that to my attention, because that's definitely something I'm going to look into.
Yeah, it's some really cool stuff.
Awesome, man. Well, I think that's it for your time. Thank you so much for listening to the show, being a fan of the band, the show, everything. Really appreciate you, man. That's why we're doing these things, to kind of talk to some of the people who are actually a part of this community that I'm trying to build in Drinks with Johnny and have been there for so long with the Avenged Sevenfold stuff. So I really appreciate you and your time, man.
Thank you. I appreciate you doing this. You know, it's your podcast is great. I like that you just have real conversations with people, you know, just I think there's a lot more to gain from that rather than just a regular interview format.
I appreciate that, man. That's the goal. You know, I've done a lot of interviews in my time and they're not fun for me. They're not fun for the interviewer. Let's just be real and talk. You know what I mean? That's what it's all about.
I think being authentic just goes a long way.
Absolutely.
And then just thanks for being an awesome band. You know, since I was 15 years old, I have a stingray because of your tone on City of Evil. So
awesome, man. Well, thank you. Yeah. Well, maybe a signature is in your future as well at some point from Schecter. You know, it's a pretty good bass too.
Yeah. I'd love to see, I haven't seen any, like demos of your bass anywhere. I've tried to search it on YouTube or anything just to kind of get an idea of what the sound is. Cause I know you were saying it's like a cross between a stingray and a Rick, which is awesome. I just want to be able to like play one and, you know, see one in person.
Well, you just brought that to my attention. There's not enough demos out there. I'm going to talk to you guys over at Schecter. You need to make a demo video. I'm not going to do it. I'm too fucking lazy for that. So we got to get a demo video together. Thank you for bringing up that point. We'll do that. And you got a Guitar Center or a Sam Ash? What do you got next to you?
Yeah, I got both. They're usually within like 10 minutes of each other around here.
Yeah, and there's still no Johnny Christ signature basses in there?
I've not seen one.
All right. I'm getting on the phone. Mark LaCourte, you're in fucking big time trouble, buddy. We got to get some out there. All right, man. Thank you very much for the time. Have a good time. Good rest of your day, and we'll talk soon, man.
Thanks, you too.
Cheers.